Good evening. I'd like to welcome everyone to tonight's lecture. It's a special pleasure and honor to introduce my own father, Rabbi Dr. Leo Davids. Unbiased as I am, I can say that he's a person who combines both Torah knowledge and tremendous general knowledge, which I think which you'll be able to see over the course of tonight's lecture.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I am very happy with the turnout. We have, Baruch Hashem, a very nice crowd here tonight. And I think it makes sense for me to speak and try to project my voice and sort of see everybody and hear everybody as well as possible. I too have graduated to maturity, and I have these little devices here, which are supposed to be helpful. So I'm not the only one, I think, using these assistive contraptions. Now, my topic tonight is Yiddish, from its earliest beginnings, where it came from, how it came to be, and on to sort of Zman Hazeh, what's going on today. What I will try to do is to use the map, first of all. Everybody has a little map, hopefully. If you don't have one, you can share with a neighbor. Use the map to sort of look at the travels of the Jews in Europe. We'll be doing some of that, and the map should be helpful, unless you know the European map very well in your head. I thought we need this in front of us. And then talk a little bit about the sort of linguistic layers of Yiddish. You know, you put down a one layer, a roved, and then you have roved sheni, a second layer, and another strata, until you build it up. So we'll be seeing how this happens over a period of many centuries. Now, the key, I think, to working with an audience, I learned many years ago from a very wise man in Toronto, the late Rabbi Witte, Yitzhak Witte, who was the head of the Board of Jewish Education. And he always started with a little funny story or something, and then he could talk about anything, and the audience was with him from day one. So let me give you a flavor of the people who speak Yiddish. Two grandmothers meet at the street corner, and coming along the street, Mrs. Goldberg, how are you? How's everything? And one of them has these two little kids with her, you know? And the other woman says to her, oh, Mrs. Goldberg, is that your grandchildren? Yes, they are, indeed. She says, oh, how old are the darlings? She says, the doctor is 6, the lawyer is 4. Just sort of know how people think when you speak Yiddish. In any case, I wanted to also thank the people who made this evening possible, and I think of Rabbi Kelman here, who's with Avichai. He worked very hard to get this thing going, publicize it, and repeat it with notices and so on to people on his list, and I much appreciate the goodwill and the hard work he did. Rabbi Eisenberg, of course, who is just coming back from Europe sometime this evening. I don't know when he may pop in or not. And if not, hopefully we'll see him 2 weeks from now on the Wednesday when, Mitzvah Hashem, I'll have another topic in the same location. Now, first of all, let's define Yiddish, because people sometimes kind of get confused as to what Yiddish really means. Of course, we shouldn't forget Mrs. Soller and Mr. Soller, who opened up and made sure there's some cookies out here and the lights are on and so on. And they are people who are shochen tov, they are here in the building. We don't want to forget their contribution, of course, as well. In any case, Yiddish I would define as whatever Jews speak to each other within the community. It's not a specific language or a specific vocabulary. Yiddish, I would define as that which Jews speak to each other within the community. Jews are always, in some sense, multilingual, because they speak to each other in a certain way and with a certain vocabulary, and they speak to the non-Jewish people among whom they live in a somewhat different way, with a somewhat different language. And sometimes they are bilingual, trilingual, quadrilingual. A typical Hasidic Jew in Montreal will speak Yiddish, Hebrew, English, and French. And this is standard. You go to City Joe, Montreal, you speak, and you actually speak them, all of them. You know, some better, some worse. The Hebrew may be more prayer book Hebrew rather than early Hebrew, but you can read it, you understand it, and certainly people typically have a large language cargo in their baskets. Now, having defined Yiddish as that which Jews actually speak, this suggests, and I think that's an important point to keep in mind from the outset, that the content of Yiddish changes over time. Yiddish is not the same thing in the year 1200, 1400, 1800, tomorrow, last week. It's different because the components that go into it depend on the environment, the speech environment in which people function. And so the idea of what Jews use to speak to each other in the community, of course, is different in different communities, at different times, and at different places. So even Yiddish is not the thing officially. It hardly can be that. Now, as Jews, after the destruction of the First Temple, the Second Temple, etc., went into exile and had to go out of their own ancestral country and go to other places, of necessity, they mixed Hebrew into whatever else they were speaking. So if you are looking at a library in a big university, Hebrew U or other places like that, you'll find works in Judeo-Persian, Judeo-Arabic, Judeo-Spanish, Judeo-German, which we call Yiddish, and so on and so on and so on. Why? Because Judeo-anything is Hebrew, which is mixed with whatever people are speaking. Now, what I say to another Jew, this morning I put on my phylacteries. When they stop laughing, they'll ask you for a dictionary. What are phylacteries? Well, you and I know, if we've written down the secret, that phylacteries is some fancy Greek word for tefillin. A Jew would never say to another Jew phylacteries because it's all too ridiculous. Neither would the Jew say to the next guy, I came on Saturday to shul. Come Shabbos to shul, not Saturday. So the Hebrew is simply part of the life we live and the things we're familiar with, and we use those Hebrew terms even if we're speaking Persian, Arabic, Spanish, doesn't matter what we're speaking. So there's always a Judeo hyphen something the Jews speak to each other, as opposed to the full Castilian or the full Arabic or the full whatever they're speaking, Farsi, if they're talking to their Gentile neighbors. Okay, let's ask a little question, which is, how did the Jews get from the Holy Land into Germany and into all these other places? How did they get there? Now, is there a route? Is there kind of a, you know, a line you can trace of how the Jews came to Europe and where they went first and where they went after? And the answer is yes, you can find that indeed. What happens is that in late antiquity, the Romans become the dominant power throughout the ancient world, the Mediterranean world, and the Roman Empire is a small little empire going roughly from Scotland to Iraq. And that's roughly the Roman Empire kind of extent, okay? Small little empire. The Islamic Empire, of course, is much bigger in its extent, but anyway. Now, the Romans had dominion for centuries over what they called Palestine, what Jews called Eretz Israel, the Romans called it Palestine, and they, during that dominion, they decided that they were going to write the rules and enforce them. And at a certain point, they decided that the Jews would, in fact, be conquerable and rulable only if they were kind of controlled and their religious beliefs, etc., were kind of pushed down. And so the Romans invented some new crimes. If you circumcise your child, that's a crime. If you study Torah publicly, that's certainly a crime, etc., etc., which we find in the Gemara in various places, which is not our topic now. But as a result of the Romans being the dominant power over the Holy Land for some centuries, including the time of the Jewish revolt around 68, 69, 70 CE, as well as later on, time of Bar Kokhba and Rabbi Akiva in the century following, because the Romans were there and they were exercising a very tough repression, the Jews found themselves, at least in small numbers, coming to Rome. How did they come to Rome? Some as slaves, some as shtadlonim, people who were interceding, who were sort of ambassadors speaking on behalf of the Jewish people to the Roman authorities and trying to deal with taxes or decrees or whatever. And so Jews first went to what we call today Italy, to the Roman dominions, in the boot of Italy and along the side, because they came either for business or for very unpleasure when they were dragged away in chains. Gemara uses this Latin word, collar. You know the collar of your shirt? Collar, tole, besavo, or whoever. I mean, collar was used as a metal ring that the prisoners were locked up in but it's, you know, it's around the neck, the collar. In any case, and there are other Latin words, of course, that occur in Gomorrah, but that's not, again, what we want to get into right now. So you begin with the Jews coming to the Roman dominions, central and southern Italy, and you see the on your map, you see Sicily, and then the boot, the bottom of the Italian boot, the heel and the toes, come up to Naples and so on. And in fact, in the Mishnah, you see occasional references to the Tannaim who were traveling. They came to Frindizin or Brindisi or whatever, you know, and they were coming and they were going, and questions about Chum Shabbos occurred. So we know that they came and they traveled to these places. Now, as time wore on, the Jews who were there, those who had been slaves were freed because their brethren would work very hard on pidyon shvuyim, on redeeming captives, and that means that they would buy them out, you know, pay ransom, whatever they needed to do to get them freed. And so Jews, even when they came in as prisoners, slaves, etc., tended not to stay there that long because they had help to get out of those situations and to get a better status. So once the Jews were free, most of them were free sooner or later, they moved up the west coast of Italy and came to, on the map, you go to Monaco, to Turin, to Marseille in the south of France, and Jews spread out in those areas. What lures people to leave one town and go to another? Well, roughly the same kinds of things that lure people in later times, and that is what we would call business opportunities. How many moneylenders can you have in one neighborhood? Okay? And the Jews are expected to do moneylending and not to do landed work, and not allowed to be part of the guild. They're not admitted with the silversmiths and the goldsmiths and all these other people in the guilds. So Jews are doing moneylending, but you know, after a while, you've got to spread out, otherwise you're not going to make any money. So Jews are looking for a better livelihood, are in fact going to move to the next town, and try to see if they can do better there economically. Now, as you go up Italy, and as I say, the south coast of France, you decide, well, let's go a little further north. There is a little obstacle in your way, just a little obstacle. It's called the Alps. And the Alps are, in today's countries, not in those days, these countries didn't exist, but in today's country, Austria, Switzerland, the northern tier of Italy, the east of France, the Alps kind of dominate that part of Europe. So you don't go straight up, you know, through the passes, there are some, but you go a little bit west, and you come around in eastern France, and you sort of trickle northward, and eventually you get to the Rhineland. The Rhineland, which is where the River Rhine, which, like the other big river of Europe, Danube, comes out of the melting of the snow of the Alps. Okay, these rivers are alpine waters initially. That's how the rivers start. So the Rhine comes out of there. It becomes, in modern times, the border between Switzerland and Germany, as it flows westward. Then it turns at Basel. I've been to Basel, to this little place where the three countries are together in one place, called the Dreiländer Eck, the three lands corner. And here you have Germany, here you have France, here you have Switzerland. And interesting to see these things. And then it turns and it goes north. And when it goes north, it's the boundary not between Germany and Switzerland, but between Germany and France, right? But the Jews are there, and of course in the time of Rashi is a good 1,000 years ago, right? At least 1,000 years, maybe a touch more, 1,000 years ago, the Jews are already in the northeast of France, northeast of France particularly. And they've sort of filtered there, sort of not through the Alps, but around west of the Alps and coming around. Now, let's come back to the language situation. If the Jews went to these places, what is the sort of dominant Gentile language around them that they hear in Italy and then up into France? Well, it's Latin or some slightly modified version of Latin, which you may call Old French or Old Italian or Old whatever, but it starts out as Latin. And so you would expect that if Jews were doing Judeo something, there would be some kind of a Judeo-Latin as you enter the Middle Ages, right? If you're coming to Rome is destroyed by the Vandals, you know, the Vandalized. No, the Vandals come to Rome, destroy it. That's 410. So the Jews are already in Europe by that time, obviously. They've been there for a while. So they're speaking some sort of a Judeo-Latin. You say, well, is that still visible, or I shouldn't say visible, it's still audible today in Yiddish? Does Yiddish have any traces of that kind of Latin influence? And the answer is certainly. What do you do after you finish a bread meal? You bench, which is benediction, benedict, baruch.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, that's proper Latin. It's still there, benching. We still do that verb, which is based on Latin. And we have names. Women's names are very good Latin names. We still have them. The most quintessential Yiddish names, the Yiddish of the Yiddish, okay, shows how far back we go. We're talking about Bella, right? That's very good Latin, Italian, Spanish, right? Bella. You have Yenta, Gentile, whatever. And you have Sprinze. What could be more Latin than Esperanza? Or Esperanto, anyway, hope, Sprinze. So Sprinze, Yenta, the quintessential Yiddish names are very proper Latin and Latin derivatives. Old French, old Italian. So that is still there from those far off times before the Jews ever got to Germany, before they got there altogether. Okay. Now, why do you take a long time to cross the Rhine and go into Germany? Well, because in Roman times, you had the Roman frontier kept by Roman troops. And on this side, you had civilization. It means you had cities, you had roads, you had bridges, and a certain kind of peace called the Pax Romana, the Roman peace. Because if you violated the peace, you could be hung on the wall, which is a little bit unpleasant. So they kept the peace. So their frontiers were naturally within Europe, the Rhine, west of the Rhine, south of the Rhine, you're in Roman territory. If you go beyond that, you're with the barbarians. Who knows what they do there? Probably eat people head first. Who knows what they do? Okay. Or the Danube. And beyond the Danube, you have Romania sort of sitting on the edge there. Beyond that, you're in the other sort of savages. So you don't want to be there. So it takes a long time for Jews to leave the Latin area and to move into areas of Europe where the language base is not, in fact, Latin and Romance languages, but other language groups. Okay. So, eventually, once the Roman Empire is gone, and 400s, 500s, it's over, you still have Latin spoken in the cities. So that doesn't suddenly, overnight, bang, you know, the Vandals have come, Vandals have gone, no more Latin, not at all. That language continues for centuries, and the Jews are involved with it for centuries, and as I said, we still see the traces in these names and so on. What you get, of course, is that eventually the Jews see that the Rhine is no longer a big boundary between civilization and, you know, the forests and the jungle, so to speak, but that, in fact, you can cross the Rhine and live to tell the tale. And so eventually they, again, looking for opportunities, looking for other places to make a living, they spread out and they go here, they go there. And if you go straight north, you know it's going to get colder and colder and colder. So you don't want to go straight north. So in terms of Scandinavia, the Jewish populations there have been very tiny. There still are some Jews there, here and there, but, you know, it's becoming less and less fun to be a Jew in Scandinavia these days, recently. But Jews never went, you know, where it's really frozen up there in the cold countries of Europe. And so eventually, if you're moving, you're not continuing north, 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 where the snow gets heavier, etc. You can move east. You get to Germany. And Germany is a place where, you know, business is done, and there are little villages, and people are working hard, they're industrious, and so on. And the Jews fit in there. There is no such thing practically as anti-Semitism and so on until the Crusades. So when the Jews come to Germany in 600, 700, 800, before the Crusades, things are quiet. They mix in with the other people. They're well accepted. Nobody asks too much. They don't worry about religion too much. And so they go. And they go along and fit in with the southern parts of Germany. Some parts of Germany where you see, you know, Munich, north of Switzerland, you see Munich, eventually moving along from southern Germany, from Bavaria, going into Austria. Vienna is the very end of the Alps. From Vienna westward, the Alps begin. They rise and rise. From Vienna onward, lowland down towards Hungary. In any case, so the Jews now have gotten out of the Italian or Latin kind of area of Europe, and they are moving into this German area. Because they are reasonably well accepted, and they are reasonably happy with their neighbors, they take on that language comfortably and speak it in, of course, doing so, they will put in Hebrew. So if you put in something like 65%, 70% German, and you put in 15 to 20% Hebrew, well, Yiddish, as we know it, is pretty well there. Now, there are some pieces that will come later, as we'll see, but basically, by the time you get to the, I don't know what, the middle of the Middle Ages, sort of 1100, 1200 time of the Rambam, certainly Yiddish, as we know it, is more or less constituted already. Mainly German, but not German of today, the German of 1200s, 1300s, and so on, and of course the Hebrew is in there, and not very much of the other. Remnants of the old Latin stuff are still carried along. Now, the kind of words you add when you're in the German area is something like Teichen. Teichen is to translate, but Teichen means Deutschen. Turn it into German so it can be understood. Translate simply means, like I would say sometimes in the classroom at York in the olden days, let's English that, meaning let's translate that into language people understand. Teichen is to Deutsch something, being the common language around them is German, so Teichen in Yiddish means to translate. And of course, all the other words basically in basic Yiddish are German. Most of them are German words that are still understood today without any difficulty. And this is simply the bulk of Yiddish vocabulary. Now, once the Crusades come along, things are really going to be different. The Crusades begin in 1095, 1096. Long story, which we're not going to get into. Bottom line is that the Christians decide to take up arms and they will go back and wrest the Holy Land back from those Muslims. The Muslims let the churches fall apart, and if you're a Christian pilgrim, you got to pay at the door, and you have the mosques. Those are wonderful things that kept clean. The people come there, you know, everything's wonderful. So Islam, you know, owns all that territory. The Christians are unhappy. The churches are in disrepair, and they decide they really got to go and conquer that back from them. And so they go and they start to do it. But as time goes on, of course, they're fighting infidels. They find that some other people don't quite believe their beliefs. That is the Jews, but the Jews are local. The Jews are not far away. The Jews are right there. So what happens is that the Jews, once the Crusades get going, are in trouble. Because anyone who's not a believer, anyone who doesn't embrace the cross, well, finish pushing. Then things are difficult. In any case, what happens after the Crusades is the Crusaders come back and 1100, 1200, the Christians begin to wake up, become more activists. And across Europe, the Christians say, you know what, we're not going to tolerate these infidels. Not the ones over there whom we fought against and eventually lost. Not the local infidels, the Jews. And so the Jews are expelled from place after place. All these little kingdoms say, Jews, heraus. They want to be Judenrein, you know the expression, free of Jews. So Jews are expelled from France, they're expelled from England, they're expelled from Germany, all kinds of places, maybe not a whole country at once, but in this province or that principality, doesn't matter. The Jews are expelled. And so all over Western Europe, Central Europe, the Jews have to leave. And that's not just Spain and Portugal, which is very famous, 1492, 1497, those expulsions, but all across Europe, Western and Central Europe, Christians are activists. They're waking up, they're saying, we won't tolerate the Jews anymore. So if they won't embrace our, you know, Savior, etc., they won't come to the church, get baptized, they have to get out. So they got out, the Jews had to leave. Now, in those days, you couldn't go to the five towns in Long Island because they hadn't been discovered yet or built. You couldn't go to Brooklyn even because the Dutch hadn't, you know, opened up Brooklyn. It only happens, you know, 1600s. So if you're expelled in the 1300s and the 1400s, okay, in a wave of expulsion, that sort of clears Christian Europe, Central Europe, Western Europe of Jews, where are you going to go? Well, you have two choices, basically. You got to go east, that's for sure. But basically, where you can go is you can go towards the terrible Turks, I mean the Ottomans, southeastward. And you are, in fact, welcomed there very nicely. And I have to tell you my best Turkish story in a minute. And you can go down there. But the Turks have a bit of a reputation. They're good killers. They kill Armenians later and other people. But they were tough, tough guys. So you may not want to go to the Turks right away. Or you can go to northeastern part of Europe, the people who are not speaking anything like German, High German, Low German, none of the above, but Polish, and beyond Polish, Russian, you know, Slovak, you name it, and all the way through. And so as the Jews have been expelled during the High Middle Ages, coming out of the Crusades and that period of Christian awakening, what then happens is that they go increasingly to, as I say, some go down to the Ottomans. Most of the Jews from the Mediterranean would go to Italy or to Ottoman dominions, etc., depending on the time, and they were comfortable there. But the Jews from Germany tended to go more towards Poland, Lithuania, Ukraine, those areas. Now what happens here is that when they go east to there, they look around at these new neighbors and they don't accept them and don't integrate with them the way they did in Germany. In Germany, the Jews felt they were among people who were, you know, living a busy life, a vain life, kept morality, etc., and they could talk to them and they were pretty comfortable. When it came to the Slavic dominions, they looked around at the Poles and so on, and they saw peasants who were not literate. Literacy was pretty well unknown if you were not clergy. Clergy were literate in Eastern Europe in the Middle Ages. Nobody else was. People who were not too good at controlling the instinct to empty alcoholic bottles, they looked down upon them as people who are, you know, for various reasons, people they weren't very interested in, not very accepting of. And so rather than take up Polish as a language that would be spoken with some Hebrew within the Jewish community, they kept the German that they had been working with for centuries and which they were comfortable with. They kept that as the language of the Jewish community. They learned Polish eventually in order to deal with their local neighbors, but they were not really embracing the Polish language or Ukrainian or Russian or anything else the way they had embraced German in earlier time. Now, this means that ultimately Yiddish becomes a kind of separate language, unlike the situation when the Jews had been in Germany, and they would speak Hebrew here and there, but doesn't matter. They could communicate with other people in the same language they communicated in within their own community. But here in Poland, it was a whole different thing. Polish was only to speak to Polish goyim, so to speak, and Yiddish, which is this Judeo-German, was kept for within the community. So that's the way it carved itself.
Like English, now, like English in Moshava Germanit.
Right. In any case, some of the words that Yiddish acquired in Poland, a very well-known word in Yiddish, shmata, that's proper Polish, szpilkas, pins and needles, that's Polish, and taka, yes indeed. You know, Japanese restaurant, kosher, taka machaya. Taka is, you know, it means yes. So these are words that came to us in Poland, and that was there. Now Poland, again, the Jews were well received, they were welcomed by the nobility, by the machers, but the common people and the Jews did not get along very well. It was sort of a mutual thing. My best Turkish story, I don't want to forget that. Jews came to Ottoman Empire after 1492 in numbers. So here's the story. In 1918, World War I is over. Finished. Okay. Ottoman Empire is finished. Centuries and centuries of decline, 1600s, 1700s, 1800s. Ottoman Empire is going down. Finally, 1918, Britain and France won. The Turks, the Germans lost. It's over. So, you know, Ataturk and these little guys took over. Whole story how they got to where they got to, but not too many diversions. They sent a letter to the last emperor, Mehmet the 22nd or whatever it was, and said to him, "You better get out of town fast, otherwise we're going to rearrange your anatomy. You know, it's all over and we want you to leave town, get out." So this guy gets a panic for some good reason, and probably not an ill-founded fear. And he goes down to the railroad station. He says, "Do you have any trains around here going out of here?" "Oh yeah, we have a little train, the Orient Express. It's a little train, just goes from Istanbul to Paris, just a small short ride. You want? That train is going, go down. It's over there." Okay. Goes and runs to the train, there's a little baggage, sits in the train, sits down. Okay. Train goes chug, starts moving westward. He's breathing a little easier, you know, because he's feeling good, he's leaving town. And along comes a guy with a funny cap. He says, "Tickets, please, tickets, tickets." The emperor knows from tickets. What? He never bought a ticket in his life. Well, he's the emperor. What? You know. Now he just got thrown out, but he doesn't have a ticket. So this little funny guy with the cap says, "Sir, where's your ticket?" He says, "I'm him at the 22nd, or whatever number they were up to, and I don't have a ticket. I ran away because they threatened my life, and I have to escape." The conductor looks at him. He says, "Your Excellency," he says, "I'm a Jew. When my ancestors were looking for a place to come to, when they had to leave places in Europe and went to the Ottoman Empire and said, 'Can we come in?' Your ancestors said, 'There's lots of room for Jews. You're good workers, you're good business people, you keep records. Come join us.'" Take it easy, your ticket is on me. My best Turkish story. I heard it from an impeccable source on CBC Radio, so this had to be. Dogma, as they say. Okay. In any case, we're now taking ourselves into the 1800s. And Yiddish has been language of the masses of Jews in Eastern Europe. They kept the German. They didn't really use the Polish among themselves, just to speak to the other guys. And same thing, Russian, Ukrainian, whatever. And comes the 1800s. And you know what? 1800s has come Great Awakening, industrialization comes, railroads come, steam engines. I mean, it's the world of Europe is being massively transformed in the 1800s. And the Jews decide that Yiddish has always been used for keeping notes for grocery lists, or saying, I'm not home, I'll see you tomorrow. Other important business which was done in Yiddish, it was used for translations. Yiddish was used to translate out of Hebrew or other things. But original creative kind of writing, serious writing, in Yiddish didn't happen because somehow it wasn't a language that had that vocabulary. So after 1850, very recent, after 1850, people who want to write in Yiddish, same Hebrew letters, etc., etc., Yiddish is written in Hebrew letters, but it's basically the German and the Hebrew that we know about, they decided that they had to enrich the vocabulary by taking in more words from French, from Greek, from whatever. And so you got, in this late Yiddish, the Yiddish that only occurs from the middle to late 1800s, you got new Yiddish words such as socialism, intellectualen, you know, or modernizatia, proper Yiddish, of course. But these are words that weren't there until you start getting into this new, you know, industrial revolution language, and you had to put in those kinds of words. And then people start to write, you know, and of course you go down, you know, Karen Hayesod, Mental Amechas Forum, and Shalom Aleichem, Aleichem Shalom. I mean, all these big writers are there, you know, lots of breeds as you go along. In any case. Why should you write in Yiddish? Because you want to reach the masses in Eastern Europe who only read Yiddish fluently. They may speak Polish, Russian, etc. They may not read it, maybe not at all, maybe very weakly. And they are interested now in knowing more about the world. The era of completely isolated, insulated Jews, you know, as they were until the 1700s, let's say, in many parts of Europe, including Western Europe, that age was rapidly drawing to a close. By the late 1800s, Jews wanted to know, they wanted to read, they wanted to be kind of exposed to the larger cultures near them, and so there was a market for Yiddish writing. The Holocaust, I don't have to talk about, we know what happened there, how many Yiddish speakers were destroyed, but because of emigration from Eastern Europe, particularly late 1800s, early 1900s, Yiddish had been transplanted to new centers of Yiddish culture, which went for quite some decades fairly strongly, whether it was Buenos Aires, whether it was Brooklyn, of course, which was like big, 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 whether it was Winnipeg, Montreal, all these places, of course, had Yiddish, if you will, colonies, which kept the language going even after 1944-45. Now today, what has happened to Yiddish, and I think we'll see that on my little tables here, which I want to distribute shortly. Today, Yiddish, as it turns out, has been sort of forsaken by most Jews, but not by Haredish Jews. Jews who are Hasidic, Yeshivish, are the ones that still want to speak Yiddish, because again, as in many language situations, you choose the language you think will serve your purposes best. If your purpose is to remain apart, to retain your values, to be safe from bad influences coming from the big bad world around you, then whatever you can do to look different, to talk different, to think different is a virtue. If not for you, then for your children. And so Yiddish was chosen by Hasidic groups and other Haredim to be something that helps them maintain their separateness, their isolation, to keep things kind of stable. Other Jews decided that they could speak other things. Now, what we do have, of course, is we amuse ourselves with Judeo-English, which is also known as Yeshivish. And I don't have to give you examples. You all know what Yeshivish sounds like. Judeo-English, in which we use Hebrew in the English. We would only speak to that way with other Jews. When we speak to someone who's not Jewish, we speak normal English. So Judeo-English is like Judeo-anything. You put a hyphen on it, you put in the Hebrew, use words that come naturally to you, and it flows. What I have been doing for years to amuse myself at York University, other than what I did in the classroom, is I would look at the census of Canada, and I would look for languages. And languages, one is called Yiddish, one is called Hebrew. Hebrew was not measured way back in the 60s and 70s by the census. If you answered Hebrew was your mother tongue or whatever, they would just throw you into Yiddish. But in the 80s, they discovered Hebrew is a separate thing from Yiddish, so they counted those. In any case, what I've done here is to put together some numbers showing you a little bit about the Jewish population in 1951, 71, 91. What did they report as single response, SR, single response, mother tongue? What's your mother tongue? Only one answer. If they said Yiddish, okay. That's a single response Yiddish mother tongue speaker. And home language. What is the main language you use to speak to each other at home? It's your home language. Now, the home language reported by the guy today is the mother tongue of the next generation. Right? If your mother tongue is Yiddish, then you know, that's because your parents spoke Yiddish at home. If you speak Yiddish at home, your children will have mother tongue Yiddish. If you don't speak Yiddish at home, even though you know Yiddish from before, your children will not have any Yiddish. So that's the way things go with any language. In any case, 1951, we start with the Judaists. Why Judaists? Well, that's a strange language. Judaists? What is that? Well, it says in a little footnote, Jews by religious denomination. The Canadian census shows Jews two ways, as an ethnic origin, which is history, and as a denomination, which is today, right? So Jews by religion is a count of Jews who consider themselves Jews, identify as Jews today. Those who say, I know my ancestors were Jewish, and I came from Jews, that's ethnic Jews. So we're not talking ethnic Jews, we're talking religious denomination Jews. Jews who say, today I am a Judaist. So Judaists in 1951, we had about 205,000 in all of Canada. Mother tongue Yiddish, one answer only, 103,600. Now that means that more than 50%, even at that time, 1951, more than 50% of the Jews reported that their mother tongue was Yiddish. Your mother tongue is the first language you learn in childhood. If you learn two or more languages in childhood, you can say, I have two mother tongues or three mother tongues, which is pretty rare. Two mother tongues is not uncommon. Three mother tongues is wild, but it happens. Some people have a single mother tongue. At home, we spoke only Exish, and Exish is my mother tongue. If you spoke Waiish, then Waiish is your mother tongue, right? Okay. So, the majority of Jews in 1951 were of Yiddish mother tongue in Canada. 1971, the numbers change. The number of Jews by religion in 1971 in all of Canada was 276,000. The number of people of Yiddish mother tongue was just under 50,000, 49,900. These people were mother tongue Yiddish, the others were mother tongue whatever. French, English, Hebrew, what kind of mother tongues? Home language, 1971. 26,300 were speaking Yiddish at home. That includes old people who were speaking Yiddish who were 70, 80, 90 spoke Yiddish, and Hasidim, Yeshivish types, etc., who spoke Yiddish, and younger families. At that time, you had a pretty good mix. 1991, 318,000 Jews. The Jewish population rises, but it doesn't rise very fast. You go 20 years, your increase isn't that big, right? Jews neither have that many children, nor are they getting a lot of immigrants coming to Canada. So it's a slow-moving thing. 318,000 Jews. Of them, mother tongue includes single response and multiple response. If you say my mother tongue was Yiddish only, that's single response. So my mother tongue, well, at home we spoke Yiddish and French. Okay, Yiddish and French. So it's Yiddish, but it's multiple response, Yiddish and other things. Put them all together, everybody that had exposure as a child to Yiddish, okay, 26,500. Compare that to 318,000, it's a fairly small percentage. You can see that the gap between Jews by denomination and Jews by mother tongue Yiddish are a bigger and bigger divergence. Home language, from 26,300, in 20 years it went to 6,600. A tremendous drop in home language. It's quite obvious. 2011, we can't really count Judaists exactly because it's a Canadian story which we're about to get into. But they made the long form of the census voluntary. And all the social scientists and all the experts were crying and screaming and pulling their hair out. You're making it voluntary, we won't get any data. which sort of true, sort of not true, but you can't really count Judaism if it's voluntary, and some people don't answer, right? But that's something we have to maintain ourselves on. In any case, mother tongue Yiddish, in 2011, we show 15,200. Yiddish home language went up, not down. It what? It went up, not down? Are these 80-year-olds still speaking Yiddish at home? Not at all. These are the Hasidim. Well, where are these Hasidim? I'll tell you where they are. Take a look. Thereof, Greater Montreal only. That's where they are, Montreal. Everywhere else in Canada, Yiddish is ancient history. But in Montreal, it's living history. Do you know that in Montreal, they have a few thousand kids, little kids who speak Yiddish. But they all have, you know, payas. Mm-hmm. That's why they speak Yiddish. Except for the girls who don't have the payas. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so you have in 2011, the mother tongue Yiddish, 60% of the national total is in fact Greater Montreal, 8,900. Home language, 90% of Canadian home language Yiddish, which we saw in 2011 as 6875, is 6150 is Montreal only, 90%. So outside of Montreal, Greater Montreal, the Tasha and all these other places, there is not much going on. So this is a typical scene for Yiddish, not just in Canada, but all over the world. Yiddish in practically every place has faded away as Jews are accepted, Jews are doing well, Jews integrate with their neighbors and linguistically they speak with them comfortably, etc., etc. Jews are quite happy in France to speak French and Denmark to speak Danish and then in Canada and other places to speak English. So the idea of a separate language, which kind of is used, you know, because we don't speak to the other guys except when we have to, I mean, this has kind of faded away.
Is the number 103 that large app because of the Holocaust?
Where are we at?
1951.
Yes.
It was a large number. Where did those Jews come from? Was that after?
No, I'm not good with the Holocaust. The Jews were speaking Yiddish and were raised in Yiddish.
Why 1951? What happened before that?
Before that, in the 1930s and 40s, when these people who answered the census question were children, they were hearing Yiddish all the time. Yiddish was a very living language in Canada in 1930s, 1940s. So in 1951, the adults were answering the census question. They were raised with Yiddish. That's their mother tongue. Doesn't mean they're speaking it anymore at that time, but they had come from a Yiddish background as children. And then as time goes on, it's being used less at home, mother tongue goes down, etc.
In the Middle Ages, in the time of Rashi and the Bali Tosfos, why didn't French take on this Yiddish, or did it?
Wherever Jews came, they had Judeo-something. So if they had Judeo-French for a while, that's fine. When you write, you don't necessarily write Judeo-French. You're writing Aramaic, or you're writing Hebrew, you're writing whatever you're writing. Speaking, no doubt they had some kind of a Judeo-French at that time, which Rashi, of course, says so-and-so balaz, so-and-so balaz, so-and-so balaz, because Rashi's first readers in those days were helped to understand difficult words in Chumash when they saw the balaz. Because they knew those things. And those balaz things are sometimes understandable to us today quite easily in words that have been preserved in higher English, which is Latin-based. Lower English is Anglo-Saxon. Higher English is Latin-based, right? So similar to Spanish and Italian and so on. So they probably had the same kind of mixing. But in later times, the German thing became dominant. The Jews were happy in Germany, they did well, and then when they were thrown out, they kept that in the rude, superstitious, you know, drunken kind of Eastern Europe where they didn't want to be mixed. Again, you choose. This gives me better prestige. I feel better speaking German in Eastern Europe than to speak the local. I speak German. Judeo-German, doesn't matter, speak English. There are other questions, perhaps?
I don't think you followed my question.
Okay.
Because you have the Dino.
Yes.
And you have mixtures of Arabic and Hebrew, but there was never a continuation of a mixture of French and Hebrew. Did it ever exist? Do any people know if it ever existed?
Well, the origins of French Jewry are spotted and speckled because the French Jews in the south, in the southwest, are sort of Sephardim, Mediterranean Jews, who are more integrated with Latin languages and even North African languages. The Jews who are settled in the northeast of France, along the Rhine and so on, Strasbourg and these places, are speaking Yiddish, a German-based Yiddish, with which they communicate to other Jews across the continent. So the French thing, they could speak to each other perhaps, but with Yiddish they could speak to a Jew in Poland, a Jew in Czech Republic, a Jew in practically any place. So, okay, what happened in Holland, where I come from once upon a time, the interesting story that happened, they had a kind of branch of Yiddish up there too, in Holland, in the early to mid-1800s. They called it jargon, which was a common term. And they, you know, my father, Oliver Shalom, always used to say, was ich dir medaber. So, that type of expression. And in the middle to late 1800s, the Dutch and Jewish authorities worked very hard to stamp out Yiddish. Stamp it out with the greatest force. No more Yiddish announcements in the synagogue, which were typically done until that time. No more Yiddish in the schools. We will not tolerate them. Go to Jewish school, you're going to learn Hebrew and Dutch, but no Yiddish. And they worked very hard to get rid of Yiddish. By the late 1800s, Yiddish had been exterminated in Holland. And I guess this is somewhat similar to what happened in other parts of Western Europe. You wanted to be a proper citizen and a proper modern guy, and a proper one who fits into the society. This Yiddish thing, you've got to get rid of that. So they kind of really pushed it up very hard.
Ben-Gurion did it.
What's that?
Ben-Gurion tried a similar sort of thing.
What? Was Yiddish?
Yes, he said, got to forget Yiddish. The language here is Ivrit.
Ivrit, yes. Yiddish is a tough old thing, but you know, it has no country, it has no army, it has no flag, it has no whatever. So eventually people decide to get rid of it and put in other things.
There are Russians coming to Israel who speak Yiddish.
Yes.
We think that they didn't have any religion, they didn't have, but like the man who takes care of this building, Gershon, his family all spoke Yiddish and he speaks Yiddish.
Yiddish in various enclaves and back corners has survived in many places and is still spoken in various places today. But generally speaking, the ones who choose Yiddish and embrace Yiddish are basically Hasidim and people like that, for whom Yiddish is a defense. It's a fortress wall, and they really want that for their children and so on. So they maintain it and they use it. But the interesting thing is that Hasidim here in this country, in Israel, all speak a fluent modern Hebrew as well. So again, they're choices. At home, without reading Yiddish with the kinder, okay, fine. So they speak. But they speak Hebrew as well, the modern language, which is, you know, which opens the door to certain things later on. But in any case.
Was there more of a leaning towards Yiddish amongst religious people, more people religious in those days? For instance, you come to New York, Delancey Street, New Orleans, Yiddish places.
See, Yiddish,
and you have a bund, or whatever they called it, of non-religious Yiddish speakers who kept it there. I don't know if you knew Professor Josh Fishman and his wife, who through his university kept the Yiddish alive in New York.
Right. No, he's a very big man of linguistics, Joshua Fishman. Yeah. In any case, the thing is that Yiddish was not a religion thing, it was a Jewish thing until recent times. Now, what I'm saying is that people who were socialists and so on, they believed in Yiddish and the language of the Jews because they were ethnic Jews, and they felt very strongly that Yiddishkeit is a matter of Jewish tradition in whatever form, not necessarily religious, and certainly not involving mitzvahs or Shabbos. That was not of interest to them. So Yiddish was a mark of being Jewish, not a mark of being religious. In recent times, if you speak Yiddish, I learned it in grade 10, 11. In Brooklyn, in Yeshiva, in Torah V'das, you learn Yiddish. But I came with the German of the 1930s, which I learned as a child in shul. Okay, Hebrew, I went to only to Jewish schools. I never was in public school in my life, never. First time I sat with Gentiles in a classroom was after high school. I went to City College and so on. And so, you know, you're exposed to Yiddish, you pick it up, whatever. But do you choose Yiddish? Do you happen to fall into Yiddish? Now, Colin Powell, you know, former Secretary of State of the U.S., speaks a good Yiddish. Doesn't make him a Jew exactly. Yeah, no, but he was working as a teenager for Jews. He was delivering stuff to Jews. And Mrs. Goldberg says, do her off, that's right. Whatever. So you know, people pick it up depending on what linguistic environment is. I'm saying now it's a choice. It's cultivated, so to speak, by the Hasidim and so on, and you know, people in a sense may say we speak Yiddish at home, don't know if you believe them, but maybe.
There were Yiddishes. Translating the Siddurim for women, for example. I remember my grandmother in Burrapur, Mishvadish Ashur. She had the Siddurim, and it was a Yiddish night.
These things were around for a long time. Yiddish was used, let's say, for translations, fine. But when they wanted to be fancy, they had to sort of invent words by hopping them from other places and bringing them in, and eventually making Yiddish into a much richer language with modern terminology in which you could talk philosophy and science and so on a little bit, which was impossible before. You didn't have the words. Yes.
I think it's a great shame that we don't have Yiddish as a living language anymore, because my late father, who did not speak a word of English, went to the States on a regular basis and did business in purely in Yiddish. Went to the Diamond Force and everything was done in Yiddish, and it's such a big connector, you know.
Yes.
An international language for Jewish people.
You came from what country?
I was born in Romania, but I was brought up in Vienna.
In Vienna.
Yiddish was my first language.
Yes. Interesting. Yes.
My father came to visit Israel in 1958, and he went to a meeting of all of his landslides. And he came and he said, we couldn't understand each other. My Yiddish has English, his Yiddish has Spanish. He said, we're all speaking Yiddish and we're not speaking the same language.
Right. I mean, Yiddish isn't an official, you know, canon of you know, this is the language. It's like Vosmeret, that's Yiddish. So if you speak with English, so that's Yiddish. If there's something else, it evolves by itself. Let me mention a couple of things not to forget. Bezrat Hashem, we have another session coming up on a quite different topic, origins of the Talmud. Quite different topic, Jewish history, but very different time. In 2 weeks, but not on Tuesday, on Wednesday. So Wednesday, March 11th, we should have another meeting here. Same style, maybe not Turkish jokes, but some other jokes, and talk a little bit about how Talmud came to be written rather than oral. And I want to thank Kelman and Rabbi Eisenberg and the people who set up and who got things ready, people in the building and so on, for your support. And I do hope that we'll see a lot of the same faces in about 15 days from now as well.
Thank you very much. Very interesting.